you remember how we met?
Absolutely. I remember very well. I was doing what everybody does at 2:30 in the afternoon. Start looking around on the internet, see what's going on. And I stumbled over you. And I think first I saw your blog. And I'm so impressed and happy when I saw that.
Thank you.
And then I tried for some reason, I'm not sure, but I got to LinkedIn and I saw you on LinkedIn. And that's when we first connected because I sent you a message on LinkedIn. I was in Baltimore, you were
in Milano,
in your office, minding your own business. And I wanted to find out more. I was very intrigued because for the last 25 or 30 years, I've been watching what people do on the internet, in the trade, and I was just so impressed with
it. And then we met at the fair.
Yes.
In Chicago.
Yes, and we met the first time in person in Chicago, and you were coming to the International Luxury Outerwear Show in Chicago, and it was great for me because I got to invite you to meet some of the people that I had known for a long time.
Was the best meeting of my life.
We had a wonderful time. We met in a restaurant. My wife Debbie was there, our buyer, and we talked about everything from the history of the fur business to Astor to to what's going on now, and of course what the trends are for the future.
I bought the book of Astor.
Yeah, you read it right after then, which was amazing because he really was one of the first global traders in the world. And of course, being in the fur industry, which was so instrumental in our country, in the United States, with the exploration and development of our country. So what I noticed was that that I identified very early is that we had a real shared passion for the fur trade and for the fur sector. And so it was not just that we had a passion for the same thing, but that we have a high passion.
Do you have a fur fetish?
Well, not exactly. I do have a fur appetite, though. I have eaten fur before, and I do love it. And since you are in Maryland, we have two specialties that we have here. We have nutria, and we have muskrat. It's a small animal that we use. And it's the flank that we use, and we use it for a lot of different furs. Very similar to beaver, but much smaller and lighter in weight. And the occasion was that on the eastern shore of Maryland, where the swamps are, we have a lot of muskrat and nutria trappers. And they have a very big festival. And I was in line, I was doing the fashion show, and making a coat for the person who won the beauty contest. And I was in line to get something to eat. And when I got up there, you had your salad, you had your vegetables. And when you get to the meat, they ask you, would you like muskrat or nutria? And you can't be impolite. You can't say, I don't eat those things.
And how was the taste?
It was actually excellent. A little what we call gamey. A little bit like eating a wild animal, but very high in protein. So I'm sure it's very healthy from eating that.
I will try.
You will try. Maybe you can get it on your friend's menu, your friend who's the chef. Maybe he can put it
in. I will
ask him, would you like to put nutria on your menu?
I have one question.
Okay, you got it. Ask me anything.
Tell me about your first fur?
My first fur? The first time I sold a fur coat?
Yes.
I will actually never forget it. I was 18 years old and I lived in Denver, Colorado. And I was in my apprenticeship. And a woman called our store and said, I would like to buy a coat. But I cannot come into the store.
No.
I live 100 miles from the store. So my boss says, Richard, you find out what she wants. You're going to drive to her house. So I drove to her house. I'll never forget the name of the town. Rifle, like a gun, Rifle, Colorado. And I drove to her house with great anticipation, not knowing what to expect, not knowing if I knew what to do, how I would do it, how she would accept me, how it would be. And I was very, very nervous. So we did a fashion show, and it turned into almost like a party. And I kept thinking to myself, uh-oh, I thought I was just gonna come, show her the coat, and go home. And we went through, and we had a wonderful time, and her friends helped pick her out. But I think it was really that nervousness that went into excitement that I remembered, that here she was getting something. Of course, it was very expensive. I had never sold anything for $8,000. I mean, it was just, I was 18 years old. It was just like a lot of money. And the amount of pleasure and the amount of feelings that she got from it. And I learned then that there's a DNA connection between women and furs and how it makes them feel. And I was so excited that I was almost like on a high, because we had no cell phones, so there was no way for me to tell my boss. So I had to drive all the way back that night, put the coats away, and wait till the next day. And of course, I was very proud that I had done that, and she was so happy. So it was
so emotional.
So emotional, so much fun. This is my great-grandfather, who came from Kisvárdi, Hungary. He's the founder of our company, Mano Swartz, and his name is Mano Swartz. He was a man of letters, and he came to the United States in the 1800s. And he married Dina Sachs of the Sachs family. So yeah, so we're related to the Saxes. And his son, he had a couple sons, but his son, my grandfather, James Mano Swartz, Jimmy Swartz, has his Marine pin here. And he was from the top to the bottom. He had friends such as Menachem Begin, who was a prime minister of Israel. He was given a leopard rug by Winston Churchill. So he had friends in high places. But what really struck me about my grandfather, which really touched me, was that he really was for the everyday person. And I learned so much from my grandfather. He was really a marketing genius. He started the Veterans Day sale, and his life slogan was, "Don't thank me, just do something for someone else." His whole mission in life was to help people and not get recognition from them. So over here is my father, Mr. Mano. This was painted in 1986, and my father was brought tremendous professionalism and management to our business. And along the way, there's not a day that goes on when someone doesn't come in here and something happens and I hear my father's voice.
No.
And it might be, he might say, "Richard, when you have the chance to take advantage of someone, that's the time you don't, when they don't." So he taught me so many life lessons. So he was the last, he was the one in my ear, but a lot of it was coming from my grandfather and my great-grandfather. So that's really the story of our business, of having a business that is passed on from one generation to the other. And the business school is really the family dinner. So now he's the third, and next will be my portrait.
When you will be
65.
Ah, 65.
So my wife says, "You don't get a portrait till you're 65.
This is a lot of fur.
Yes, we're at the storage vaults of Mano Swartz Furs. This is where we house the furs for our customers during the summer. We keep them in a temperature cool vault so that the fur will not dry out. We also condition the fur, which is moisturizing the pelts. Mm-hmm. The pelts are organic, like our skin, and we don't want them to dry out. Ah, so we make it beautiful for the summer, and then we do any kind of work and minor repairs that we need to do. We put the initials in or the monogram in, so that in the fall, it'll be all ready for her to pick it up at our store and wear it for another year.
Richard, how many fur are here?
There are thousands and thousands of furs here. It takes us a long time to count them, but once we get to 20,000, that's when we build another storage vault.
Richard, what is this?
Oh, each coat has a tag with an individual unique number on it so that when our customer calls us, we can find it easily. It also identifies what work is to be done and the corners are cut when mm-hmm. each process is done. And of course, any minor repairs. You can see on this coat, she cut off the corner so that we knew that it was done. This way we can look at all our tags and know everything is ready for a cold winter.
Richard, I love your job because every single fur have a different story. And I was thinking about this pink one.
This has a very unique story. This pink looks like it would belong to somebody very wild, but in reality, it belongs to a famous politician from Maryland.
Really?
And not just a politician, a very conservative politician. And yes, this is a vest that we made for her in pink, reversible. When you put it on this side, you have the quiet Republican. And when you put it on this side, you've got the liberal person. Fur is the most unique product in the whole world. It's only limited by the imagination of the designer.
Ciao for now, Richard.